Dr. Ox's Experiment by Jules Verne. Chapter 1. How it is useless to seek, even on the best maps, for the small town of Quiquendone. If you try to find, on any map of Flanders, ancient or modern, the small town of Quiquendone, probably you will not succeed. Is Quiquendone, then, one of those towns which have disappeared? No. A town of the future? By no means. It exists, in spite of geographies, and has done so for some 800 or 900 years. It even numbers 2,393 souls, allowing one soul to each inhabitant. It is situated 13.5 kilometers northwest of Oudenaard and 15.25 kilometers southeast of Bruges, in the heart of Flanders. The Var, a small tributary of the Scheldt, passes beneath its three bridges, which are still covered with a quaint medieval roof, like that at Tournai. An old chateau is to be seen there, the first stone of which was laid so long ago as 1197 by Count Baldwin, afterwards emperor of Constantinople. And there is a town hall with Gothic windows, crowned by a chaplet of battlements, and surrounded by a turreted belfry, which rises 357 feet above the soil. Every hour, you may hear there a chime of 5 octaves, a veritable aerial piano, the renown of which surpasses that of the famous chimes of Bruges. Strangers, if any ever come to Quiquendone, do not quit the curious old town until they have visited its Stadtholder's Hall, adorned by a full-length portrait of William of Nassau by Brandon, the loft of the church of Saint Magloire, a masterpiece of 16th-century architecture, the cast-iron well in the spacious Place Saint-Ernulf, the admirable ornamentation of which is attributed to the artist-blacksmith Quentin Metsys, the tomb formerly erected to Mary of Burgundy, daughter of Charles the Bold, who now reposes at the Church of Notre Dame at Bruges, and so on. The principal industry of Quiquendone is the manufacture of whipped creams and barley sugar on a large scale. It has been governed by the Van Tricasses from father to son for several centuries, and yet Quiquendone is not on the map of Flanders. Have the geographers forgotten it, or is it an intentional omission? That I cannot tell. But Quiquendone really exists, with its narrow streets, its fortified walls, its Spanish-looking houses, its market, and its burgomaster. So much so that it has recently been the theater of some surprising phenomena, as extraordinary and incredible as they are true, which are to be recounted in the present narration. Surely there is nothing to be said or thought against the Flemings of Western Flanders. They are a well-to-do folk, wise, prudent, sociable, with even tempers, hospitable, perhaps a little heavy in conversation, as in mind. But this does not explain why one of the most interesting towns of their district has yet to appear on modern maps. This omission is certainly to be regretted. If only history, or in default of history the chronicles, or in default of chronicles the traditions of the country, made mention of Quiquendone. But no, neither atlases, guides, nor itineraries speak of it. Monsieur Joan himself, that energetic hunter after small towns, says not a word of it. It might be readily conceived that this silence would injure the commerce, the industries, of the town. But let us hasten to add that Quiquendone has neither industry nor commerce, and that it does very well without them. Its barley sugar and whipped cream are consumed on the spot. None is exported. In short, the Quiquendonians have no need of anybody. Their desires are limited. Their existence is a modest one. They are calm, moderate, phlegmatic. In a word, they are Flemings, such as are still to be met with sometimes between the Scheldt and the North Sea. Chapter 2, in which the Burgomaster Van Tricasse and the Councillor Niklas consult about the affairs of the town.
"You think so?"
asked the Burgomaster.
"I think so,"
replied the counsellor, after some minutes of silence.
"You see, we must not act hastily," resumed the burgomaster.
"We have been talking over this grave matter for 10 years, replied the counsellor Niklaus, "and I confess to you, my worthy Van Tricasse, that I cannot yet take it upon myself to come to a decision."
"I quite understand your hesitation,"
said the burgomaster, who did not speak until after a good quarter of an hour of reflection.
"I quite understand it, and I fully share it. We shall do wisely to decide upon nothing without a more careful examination of the question."
"It is certain," replied Niklaus, "that this post of civil commissary is useless in so peaceful a town as Quiquendone."
"Our predecessor," said Van Tricasse gravely, "our predecessor never said, never would have dared to say, that anything is certain. Every affirmation is subject to awkward qualifications."
The counsellor nodded his head slowly in token of assent. Then he remained silent for nearly half an hour. After this lapse of time, during which neither the counsellor nor the burgomaster moved so much as a finger, Niklaus asked Van Tricasse whether his predecessor, of some 20 years before, had not thought of suppressing this office of civil commissary, which each year cost the town of Quiquendone the sum of 1,375 francs and some centimes.
"I believe he did,"
replied the burgomaster, carrying his hand with majestic deliberation to his ample brow.
"But the worthy man died without having dared to make up his mind, either as to this or any other administrative measure. He was a sage. Why should I not do as he did?"
Councillor Niklaus was incapable of originating any objection to the burgomaster's opinion.
"The man who dies," added Van Tricasse solemnly, "without ever having decided upon anything during his life, has very nearly attained to perfection."
This said, the burgomaster pressed a bell with the end of his little finger, which gave forth a muffled sound, which seemed less a sound than a sigh. Presently some light steps glided softly across the tile floor. A mouse would not have made less noise, running over a thick carpet. The door of the room opened, turning on its well-oiled hinges. A young girl, with long blonde tresses, made her appearance. It was Suzel Van Tricasse, the burgomaster's only daughter. She handed her father a pipe filled to the brim and a small copper brazier, spoke not a word, and disappeared at once, making no more noise at her exit than at her entrance. The worthy burgomaster lighted his pipe and was soon hidden in a cloud of bluish smoke, leaving Councillor Niklaus plunged in the most absorbing thought. The room in which these two notable personages, charged with the government of Quiquendone, were talking, was a parlor, richly adorned with carvings in dark wood. A lofty fireplace, in which an oak might have been burned or an ox roasted, occupied the whole of one of the sides of the room. Opposite to it was a trellised window, the painted glass of which toned down the brightness of the sunbeams. In an antique frame above the chimney-piece appeared the portrait of some worthy man, attributed to Memling, which no doubt represented an ancestor of the Van Tricasses, whose authentic genealogy dates back to the 14th century, the period when the Flemings and Guy de Dampierre were engaged in wars with the Emperor Rudolph of Habsburg. This parlor was the principal apartment of the burgomaster's house, which was one of the pleasantest in Quiquendone, built in the Flemish style, with all the abruptness, quaintness, and picturesqueness of pointed architecture. It was considered one of the most curious monuments of the town. A Carthusian convent, or a deaf and dumb asylum, was not more silent than this mansion. Noise had no existence there. People did not walk, but glided about in it. They did not speak, they murmured. There was not, however, any lack of women in the house, which, in addition to the burgomaster Van Tricasse himself, sheltered his wife, Madame Brigitte Van Tricasse, his daughter Suzelle Van Tricasse, and his domestic, Lotche Jeanchieu. We may also mention the burgomaster's sister, Aunt Hermance, an elderly maiden, who still bore the nickname of Tante Nemans, which her niece Suzelle had given her when a child. But in spite of all these elements of discord and noise, the burgomaster's house was as calm as a desert. The burgomaster was some 50 years old, neither fat nor lean, neither short nor tall, neither rubicund nor pale, neither gay nor sad, neither contented nor discontented, neither energetic nor dull, neither proud nor humble, neither good nor bad, neither generous nor miserly, neither courageous nor cowardly, neither too much nor too little of anything, a man notably moderate in all respects, whose invariable slowness of motion, slightly hanging lower jaw, prominent eyebrows, massive forehead, smooth as a copper plate and without a wrinkle, would at once have betrayed to a physiognomist that the Burgomaster van Tricasse was phlegm personified. Never, either from anger or passion, had any emotion whatever hastened the beating of this man's heart or flushed his face. Never had his pupils contracted under the influence of any irritation, however ephemeral. He invariably wore good clothes, neither too large nor too small, which he never seemed to wear out. He was shod with large square shoes with triple soles and silver buckles, which lasted so long that his shoemaker was in despair. Upon his head, he wore a large hat, which dated from the period when Flanders was separated from Holland, so that this venerable masterpiece was at least 40 years old. But what would you have? It is the passions which wear out body as well as soul, the clothes as well as the body, and our worthy burgomaster, apathetic, indolent, indifferent, was passionate in nothing. He wore nothing out, not even himself, and he considered himself the very man to administer the affairs of Quiquendone and its tranquil population. The town, indeed, was not less calm than the Van Tricasse mansion. It was in this peaceful dwelling that the burgomaster reckoned on attaining the utmost limit of human existence, after having, however, seen the good Madame Brigitte Van Tricasse, his wife, precede him to the tomb, where surely she would not find a more profound repose than that she had enjoyed on earth these 60 years. This demands an explanation. The Van Tricasse family might well call itself the Jeannot family. This is why. Everyone knows that the knife of this typical personage is as celebrated as its proprietor, and not less incapable of wearing out, thanks to the double operation, incessantly repeated, of replacing the handle when it is worn out, and the blade when it becomes worthless. A precisely similar operation had been going on from time immemorial in the Van Tricasse family, to which nature had lent herself with more than usual complacency. From 1340, it had invariably happened that a Van Tricasse, when left a widower, had remarried a Van Tricasse younger than himself, who, becoming in turn a widow, had married again a Van Tricasse younger than herself, and so on, without a break in the continuity from generation to generation. Each died in his or her turn with mechanical regularity. Thus the worthy Madame Brigitte Van Tricasse had now her second husband, and unless she violated her every duty, would precede her spouse, he being 10 years younger than herself, to the other world, to make room for a new Madame Van Tricasse. Upon this, the burgomaster calmly...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.